Mrs. Morris and the Ghost by Tracy Wilton.
Chapter 11. Charlene stopped at a hardware store to pick up felt sliders for the furniture she'd have delivered and a selection of light bulbs, including the long tubes. She'd call Parker to see if he could put them in. Next, she went to the local market to leave another message on the bulletin board regarding her cat. She scanned the notices, but didn't find one matching the lost Persian. She was home by 1:45 and found Nick hunched over, meticulously painting the trim. In jeans, a baseball cap, and a long-sleeve paint-splattered Henley, he met her gaze with stubbornness in his turquoise eyes. "This seem all right to you?" he asked. "Great! Why do you ask?" "I found a few spots yesterday that needed sanding pretty bad. Did the best I could, but I like smooth surfaces to begin with." He brushed it over with pride. "I imagine that makes the painting easier." "It looks fine to me." Charlene looked at it again just to be appreciative. "The porch will see some wear and tear, so I wouldn't worry about it."
"Well, you just call me if you need a touch-up."
He turned to smile at her, his baseball cap twisted to the side over dark brown curls.
"I checked around the outside like you asked and didn't see any way for the cat to sneak in."
"Thanks. I put another notice up at the grocery store, so maybe somebody will call." Charlene cleared her throat, careful not to offend. "Lots of businesses like yours put up notices too, if you're looking for some more work."
Nick nodded.
"Sure.
I can help with your flyer, if you'd like. I was a marketing major in Chicago. Anyway, a second set of eyes is never a bad idea, to catch spelling errors or whatever."
He blushed, ducked his head, and nodded. "Thanks. I usually use spell check, but I was in a hurry."
Charlene laughed. "I know how that goes." She opened the door. "I'm expecting Archie Higgins from Vintage Treasure to deliver a mirror." "Just tell him to come in, if you don't mind. There's still so much work yet to be done, but I guess I can't expect it to be otherwise, can I?"
"You don't need to do it all yourself. Maybe once I'm done with this,
I might accept your offer." If she couldn't find Parker to install the overhead tubes, she'd ask Nick.
"Please do."
He went from shy to arrogant in a heartbeat.
"It'll be my pleasure."
Charlene waved off his flirtation. Once inside, she took off her coat and shoes and slid on a pair of slippers. She poured an iced tea and brought it to her bedroom. She still had boxes to unpack, clothes to sort, and her jewelry to put into a safe place until she could buy a locked box. Having workers in the house and renting to strangers was not the same as living in the safety and security of a single-family home, as her mother kept reminding her. She had cleared one box and was working on the second when she heard someone calling out her name from the foyer.
"Mrs. Morris?"
Charlene left her living area and rushed down the hallway to greet, not Archie, but a stranger. The man was tall, probably 6'3 or so, lanky, with long, straight gray hair to his chin. His cheeks were sunken, his face grizzled and lined, his eyes a dull brown. She stopped so there was a good 2 feet between them. "Hello?"
"Ma'am, I'm Parker Murdoch. Talked to Will Johnson down at the coffee shop. He said to give you my number for handyman services."
"Yes." Relief settled her shoulders. "Nice to meet you. Call me Charlene, please." She shook his hand. "You were on my list of people to contact, so I'm glad you just came by. I love the work you did on the wine cellar." His expression soured.
"Never got to finish it properly, but I'm glad you liked what I did."
He scratched his neck and stuffed his hands in his pockets. It was hard to believe this was the man who had done such ornate woodwork on Jack's wine cellar. He gave off more of a backwoods farmer vibe than an artist, but looks could be deceiving. "It won't be full-time work, but in a house this size, there will always be something to fix. Like right now, my electrical system in the kitchen burned out. I tried the fuse box, but that didn't do the trick. Later this afternoon, I'm having a large mirror delivered, and I'll need some help hanging it."
"I charge $40 an hour.
"I can handle that." She cleared her throat and changed the subject with the goal of getting Parker to open up about the Strathmores and their married life. Did Jack Strathmore pay you in cash or by check? I'd like to do the same.
Cash, ma'am. Punctual, too.
Felt bad about his passing.
He had more work lined up for me, but his wife didn't want me hanging around. That's why the cellar didn't get finished, he said, as if wanting to make sure that Charlene knew he hadn't slacked off on the job.
Her loss, not mine.
Shauna Strathmore?
Jack had said he'd overheard Shauna berating Parker after his death.
Did you know her well?
His jaw set as if he debated how to answer her.
Met her once or twice. After Mr. Strathmore died, she was in a rush to get the place sold.
I don't mean to pry, she said, but do you know if Jack and Shauna were happy?
He crossed his long arms in front of his narrow waist and shut down her questions.
That wasn't any of my business. I'll take care of the electrical problem. You want to show me what's what?
Of course. She pointed to the kitchen. The under-the-counter lights are no longer working. Neither is the light fixture over the table. Changed the bulbs, but that didn't fix the problem. The garbage disposal won't come on now either. If you need a ladder or tools, I have some in the garage.
Right, Parker said. I'll go see.
Charlene went outside beneath the oak tree and called for the cat, and silently called for Jack. She wanted to ask about Brandy and tell him Shauna had stood her up. Tomorrow, she would get to the furniture stores, buy her desperately needed beds, and pop in unannounced at Shauna's art gallery. Charlene was good with people, and she figured with a few carefully worded questions, she'd know right off the bat if Shauna could have murdered Jack or not. Neither answered, and she went back inside. Parker had reworked the wiring and got everything sorted in what she considered record-breaking time. For $40 an hour, she was certainly getting her money's worth. She was just complimenting him on that fact when Archie and his worker arrived. The men were hauling the mirror from the white van, with vintage treasures rimmed in gold on the side panel door. The framed mirror wobbled unsteadily as they slid it into an aluminum moving dolly. They strapped it in, and Parker helped guide it up the sanded porch into the living room.
"Where do you want this, miss?" Archie asked, sweat pouring down his forehead.
"Over the fireplace," she said.
"Okay, let's put it down."
The three men brought it to the floor, and Parker retrieved the 18-foot ladder from the kitchen.
"Weighs more than 100 pounds, I reckon," Archie said. "We're going to need the studs to drill into, or you'll wake up to find a lot of broken glass on your floor."
"Isn't that bad luck?" Charlene watched with apprehension. "Be careful!" Parker scaled the ladder with a hammer in one hand and molly bolts in another.
"Okay, this baby is going to need some heavy-duty anchors. Let me locate the studs, find the height where you want it to hang, and then I'll get it done."
He glanced down. "You guys think you can lift it onto the mantle when I'm ready?"
Archie and his assistant nodded. She watched in silence as the men worked, when suddenly something caught her eye. Jack sat in the velvet-winged chair watching the proceedings. His jaw was set like granite, and his hands were fisted on the carved armrests. He shot her a look, his eyes like blue chips. What was he fuming about now, she wondered. Had he overheard her conversation with Parker? She jerked her head towards the door. He ignored her. She mouthed the words, "Out." Instead, he resettled into the chair, the white of his dress shirt bright against the burgundy velvet, and elegantly lifted one leg over the other. Even arrogant and angry, he was incredibly handsome. Shauna's cheating was hard to understand. If Jack had been cruel, that would be different. But from what she knew of him, he might snap, but he'd never be unkind. Charlene couldn't imagine a cheating spouse. The betrayal would be devastating. She wanted to empathize and offer comfort, but when she tried to hug him, her hand had gone right through. Jack wasn't a man, just the ghost of one. A knock sounded at the front door. She answered, expecting to see Nick asking if he could help her. But it was Sam. Her stomach did a silly twirl. She smoothed the stray hair off her cheek and tucked it behind her ear. She peeked out at the porch, but Nick's battered green truck was gone, so he must have left for the day. Figured plenty of male help already available? She stepped back with a warm smile for Sam. Would you like to come in?
I was in the neighborhood and thought I'd see how the cat eviction was going.
Nobody has called to claim him. I guess you still haven't heard of anybody missing a large Persian with entitlement issues?
Sam chuckled and stepped inside, his gaze drawn to Archie and the men straining the mirror over the fireplace. That looks great, like it was made for that spot.
I found it at the antique shop.
I'm glad you like it. I bet you'll be ready well before Halloween. Are you officially open and taking reservations yet? My sister and her husband are coming into town, and I told her about this place.
You did? Charlene put her hand on his forearm. Thank you. Yes, I'm ready, not for guests, but for reservations. I'll get you a business card and have her call me. She will be my first guest.
Halloween is the busiest night of the year in Salem. You won't have any problems filling the rooms.
You have any other family coming into town?
She spoke like in a teasing voice and immediately inched away. That, Charlene, sounded a lot like flirting. No, but I can try to drum you up more business.
Clearing her throat, she said, thank you. Can I get you something to drink?
She had some questions about Shauna that she hoped to ask in a casual way. Sam eyed the men in the living room. Nah, you seem like you're busy. I'll just get that card. Her name's Sydney. Husband is Jim. Jim Taylor.
Very good. I'll be right back.
She went into the kitchen and opened her purse, which was on the counter. Jack materialized next to her and she swallowed a gasp.
What is it now?
Careful, Jack said, his mouth firm. Sam will think you're talking to yourself. Crazy. He circled his finger in a loop. She glared at him, then took a card and turned her back on Jack, bristling as he chuckled. She marched up to Sam.
Here it is. I look forward to her call.
He took the card and nodded his approval. Very nice. Classy.
Annoyed with Jack and his attitude, she put on a bright smile. I'll make sure that their stay is perfect.
Maybe Sydney and hubby would like to see a ghost, Jack suggested at her elbow. Charlene fought to keep a straight face as she ushered Sam out the door.
I appreciate you stopping by. I'll keep you posted on the cat situation.
Another week and it will have squatter's rights, Sam joked.
Not funny.
Sam winked and went out to his SUV. Charlene waited until he was on the street and only the taillights visible before whirling around to Jack, who was, of course, no longer there.
Jack, she muttered, we have got to talk.
Archie and his helper came out. Charlene thanked them for doing a great job and slipped a tip into the helper's hand. Parker lurked at the doorway. You need me for any more chores?
Not today, but I appreciate your help and will call you again, I'm sure.
She glanced up into his bitter face. Was Jack positive that Parker couldn't be a killer? He looked the part far more than shiny Shauna.
How much do I owe you?
I've been here 2 hours, ma'am.
I'll give you 100. She handed him the cash.
Nice tip. Thanks, he said, slipping it into his pocket.
If you remember anything else about Jack and Shauna, please share. I feel like I should know them, being as I've moved into their house.
Parker tilted his head and gave her a dry smile. Charlene, this is your house now.
She wished it were true,